Okay, cool.
People, yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Okay then.
Speaking.
Yeah. We get into it.
Yeah, yeah. And if you have any questions, people, please put it in the chat pod. As soon as I have the YouTube link, I'll post it there. So good luck, Chinmayko.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Welcome everyone. This is a general introduction to the world of spreaders. So basically. Let's begin with what actually is a spider. So all the animals under the order Araneae, they are basically spiders. So spider is an eight-legged air-breathing terrestrial arthropod equipped with chelicerae, which is mostly equipped with venom glands, have the ability to spin silk. So this looks quite complicated, but and it belongs to the order Araneae. And why should we study spiders? So basically, study of arachnids is called arachnology, and the study of spiders in particular is called arenology. And why make spiders? The first point is spiders are bioindicators. The presence of spiders in any ecosystem indicates that this they're what. Proportional and dependent upon how rich the habitat around is. Some studies have showed that they give out if the habitat is pristine or degraded. So, and yeah, they are really good bioindicators of any ecosystem, and they play a vital role in maintaining balance because basically, they predate on how do they provide balances? They predate on many small insects, and they are in turn predated upon by big animals like bats, birds, and they complete the food chain. And as said, spiders are bioindicators because, in simple words, if there's a pristine habitat and good vegetation, then that good vegetation will definitely have certain good number of insects. Which when there are good number of insects, when the prey is there, the predator must be there. Then if there are a predator like spider will be more. So this in turn is an indication of a really good ecosystem. And yeah, their numbers vary depending upon how disturbed the habitat is. This is just simple words. There are various other factors which play in this water. When we say that spiders are bioindicators, while studying the Atlantic forest of North America, said that the spider populations are dependent upon the tree varieties and what the foliage cover there. Yeah, in different habitats, there are various factors which in turn affect the number of spiders. But the truth be told, spiders are really good bioindicators, and yeah, in turn tell the health of an ecosystem. So spiders are as they feed on all the insects and all. So second point, spiders are really good biocontrol agents. So effective biocontrol agents, and a recent study, like 1 or 2 years back, I estimated that there are around 27 million tons of spiders, and they eat around 440 to 880 million tons of insects each year. So 880 million tons of insects is like more than the combined biomass of humans. So these, if like it is like eating, if spiders were to eat humans, they can like easily finish us within a year. And as like their presence in households means that they also feed on pests like cockroaches, mosquitoes, flies, which can cause diseases. So they help in maintaining health in every household or in the ecosystem, and helps us humans from, and by preventing diseases by eating those pests and host carrying insects. Disease carrying insects, I mean. And they also feed on agricultural pests and their eggs, providing vital eco service for free. Spiders not only feed just on the insects, but there have been what records of spiders eating the eggs of insects. So, you know, like pests like locust cause lot of trouble to farmers and all, and cause huge losses. And spiders, like good number of spiders, actually keep a check on lots of these pest insects, a lot of these pests, and help us like providing, they provide a vital ecological service, and that too for free of charge. And then there is spider venom. Spider venom has many useful properties. The spider venom, we are just like, it's like a Pandora box, and we have just started to unlock its many treasures inside this spider venom. The protein peptides present in spider venom have vast scope, and especially in medical significance, because researchers have showed that they have the ability to prevent brain damage and even combat stroke, cancer, epilepsy, and even chronic pain, among many other diseases. Still, researchers are going on about the spider venom, and yeah, it's like every other venom, when it can be turned, it can be used as medicine and it can be useful to humans. And yeah, like spider venom, this is quite a recent breakthrough, I believe, has been used to create eco-friendly, non-toxic, insect-specific pesticides. By this, I mean when pesticides are what? When pesticides are used on crops, like not only the pest attack the crops, even benefactory insects like moths, butterflies, and other pollinators also visit the crops, and they are really honeybees, even honeybees. So they are really essential for the functioning of an ecosystem. And yeah, we know that how important honeybees among others are. So, but if the crop is sprayed by pesticides, pesticides is a broad spectrum thing, so it will just kill off all the things which come in contact with it. I mean the insects. So generally a breakthrough has been done that for a certain moth, Helicobacter, I believe, spider venom peptides have been separated so that it acts particularly on that specific insect. So like if this kind of breakthrough happens, we can save many of the pollinators from dying, unjust dying due to pesticides. And even this pesticide made by venom is more eco-friendly compared to the chemical pesticides. Then spider silk, I don't need to give an introduction on the spider silk. So spider silk is really a miracle of nature. Spider silk has been used from ancient times by many tribes. Even some tribes of Papua New Guinea use the spider silk of the giant wood spider to catch fish by making fish traps. And from ancient time, even spider silk has been wrapped around wounds to help the wound heal quickly, because it has good antibacterial properties, and vitamin K is also present. And why spider silk is really important is because it is what for its diameter, for its size, diameter and length, it is what more than 10 times stronger steel. And it can it is more flexible than steel, malleable, ductile, what that's for what metals. But spider silk can bend, and it is one of the most flexible materials, you can say, but adaptable does adaptable materials. So the study of this spider silk is helping us make wear resistant low weight clothing. And even spider silk is so tough that it can, it is what more tough than Kevlar. Kevlar is a bulletproof fabric. So spider silk at that required like at the same capacity as at the same size of Kevlar is more bulletproof. So study of spider silk is helping us create bulletproof fabrics and even biodegradable materials, crosshair in guns, etc. And in medical advantages, as I said, it's used for it can be used for healing wounds, biodegradable sutures, artificial tendons and supports, because yeah, spider silk is really strong. And enthusiast perspective, this is my own perspective, because spiders are generally everywhere and they are really beautiful creatures, and many of them are quite easy to identify. Look, by just seeing them you can identify quite a lot of these common ones, but yeah, terms and conditions apply. Spiders, but the thing is, though they are really common, they hold lots of secrets about their behavior and biology. We literally don't know much about the everyday life of a spider. So like we can easily document and contribute to science by documenting and studying them. And compared to the, like spiders have been pretty well studied compared to other taxons, like leaving butterflies and moths to say, like even some beetles. They are compared to other bugs and all, spider's taxon has been complete like well studied, even compared to other arachnids, and we have significant amount of material if you want to look up any information. So like when you know something better, like you get more interested. So that's how an enthusiast, like that's how you can you want to study spiders, and they are quite found everywhere, and yeah, that would be helpful. And how does a spider function? And yeah, how does a spider perceive what's happening around it? So some spiders have exceptional vision, but not all. Only like two families are known to have exceptional vision, but all the spiders have exceptional sense of touch and feel. The two families are like the jumping spiders and netcaster. They are known to have exceptional vision, but other than that, others also have good vision, but not as good compared to these. All spiders have vibration and chemosensitive hairs and receptors on their legs. So they basically hear and taste through their legs. This is the eye of a jumping spider. You can see the retina. So these are quite big. The AME is like the front two eyes have really good vision. They can make out, like they can perceive vision as good as humans in color. And yeah, they have 8 pair of eyes. So you can see like this, the main two pair is for giving them complete color, like depth information, but the other two give out, the other pairs give out what spatial data and 360 degree spatial data so that they can judge what's around them. This is a netcaster. So it also has really big eyes. It has phenomenal night vision because of those two big eyes. And yeah, its eyesight can be eyesight is said to be more keener than that of an owl. And yeah, as said, you can see that these are trichogothria, as said, those are what and touch sensitive. These are all the what sensitive hairs that are present on the spider's leg, and this is actually used by the spider to sense and perceive what's happening around it. And yeah, you can see that vibration receptors in the legs of a spider, and these all, and even chemoreceptors are also present. So it basically knows what is happening around it through these legs before it can see it. Like for example, a jumping spider can perceive for about, I believe, around 2 meters, it can almost see clearly. 1 meter, 1 or 2 meters, it can see clearly, but it can react to movement more than 3 meters away. So that is because of the movement at the vibrations and the chemoreceptors vibration, what sensing hair and chemical sensing hairs that are present on its legs. And spider locomotion. So spiders are basically like JCBs. JCB, I mean earth movers. They are like, you know how the piston moves through hydraulic pressure. So spiders are also hydraulic powered and a little to move forward, backward and all, like they use their muscle power. But generally, they when the hemolymph, the blood is pumped into the spider's leg, it causes it to lift and move forward. That's why when a spider is dead, it will just shrivel up. And that's because all the pressure in its legs are gone. So yeah, so spider movement is followed by a mixture of hydraulic pressure and muscle power. And spider feet, you know, spiders can climb any vertical walls. Even spiders can attach to glass and other stuff even in zero gravity. That's because they have really tiny microscopic hair on their feet. And those feet, those hair also are small triangular shapes called setules. And these attach to the surface through van der Waals forces. Let's not go into any deeper science. So that enables them to go like climb any surface, even in zero gravity. And this, like studying the spider hair, this particular hair scientists are trying to come up with spacesuits that they can like through which astronauts can walk without like feeling the effect of zero gravity in spacecraft, because spiders can do that. And that's one kind of locomotion. But there is another interesting kind of locomotion that spiders use, especially the small spiders. It's called ballooning. Ballooning is, you can see that this small spider is leaving strands of silk into the air. So what these spiders do is they find a high vantage point, and upon going to that high vantage point, they just get into this particular position and start shooting a long strand of silk. This silk is like a parachute for the spiders, and when it picks up the drafts of wind, it will start flying. It will literally start flying in the air, and this enables them to travel really large distances. And yeah, they can, like some spiders have been found above stratosphere, and yeah, so that's how some spiders even land in Antarctic and all. So it's of no use. And yeah, they do it just to travel large distances and disperse or even escape a predator. Best example for this is some small crab spiders and other small spiders. If you disturb them, they just balloon and go to. It's like just throwing a parachute and escaping. And how does a spider breathe? It has a pair of book lungs. Depends, like Myclomorphs have two pairs and Arenamorphs have one pair of book lungs and spiracles. And these are the organs used for breathing. They are just like synonymous to our lungs. How the circulatory system in spiders? It's basically an open circulatory system with a heart pumping, with the hemolymph, like. It's an open circulatory system is prevalent in all arthropods. And yeah, the blood of the spider is greenish because of the presence of hemocyanin. It's a pigment. For us, it's hemoglobin. That's why it's red. For them, it's greenish because of hemocyanin. And yeah, heart will be in the in its abdomen on the upper part. It will be constantly pumping blood throughout the body cavity. And does the spider have a brain? Of course it has. It has two big nerve ganglions in the prosoma, like it's the head part of the spider, and it has a brain. Does the spider excrete? Of course it does. And it excretes uric acid pellets with ANS, and excretory glands are Malpighian tubules. Those are like the white things you see on lizard droppings. Spider droppings are also similar. And what and how does a spider eat? So spider, like anything it can catch and kill, a spider can eat. And how does it eat it? Like some are predatory, because they chase after them like wolf spiders. Some just stay in a place calm and wait for the prey to approach them like crabbies, and some build like exquisite webs for predators for prey to come and get caught in it. And after catching the prey, the process is similar in all of them. Spiders basically don't have teeth, so they cannot chew their food. So what do they do is, when they catch their prey, they wrap it in silk and inject a venom. Venom and digestive enzymes. So basically the inside of the prey gets dissolved completely, and they have a straw-like mouth parts through which they suck out all the fluids and just discard the exoskeleton of the remaining prey. And there are a few vegetarian spider, especially there is one particular vegetarian spider which is quite famous. It's called Bagheera Kiplingi, native to South America, and it feeds on sac and pollen. And some spiders, like leaving that, many other spiders also tend to feed on pollen, like in a few rare occasions, not always. And what are the predators of spiders, like other spiders? So a spider, this is cannibalism, because both are of the same species. But if it's interspecies and one species feeds on a different species, then it's called arenophagy. And areno translates to spider, and phagy means eating, so spider eating. So predator of spiders are always spiders, because they are opportunistic hunters, and they can eat. They don't hesitate to eat other spiders if they do get an opportunity. And there is entomopathogenic fungus. You can see here, like it has been covered. And this is a dead spider. If it gets affected by, this is like a parasite of these things. A deadly parasite. Once it gets it, there is no going back. It will die. And there are wasps, certain wasps like pompilids. Pompilids are basically spider wasps. You can see here. This is a pompilid. And spacids are thread-legged wasps, especially mudhoppers. So basically these wasps actually don't directly feed on spiders per se, but they kill the spiders as it's required for, as it's the main source of protein for their young ones. So what the pompilid does is it envenomates the spider and incapacitates it by taking out all the legs. And it would have already dug a hole and kept ready. So it will get it will stack all the different spiders it gets into the hole and lay egg there, so that the larva, when it grows up, it has a good source of protein to eat. Basically, the what will happen is the spider will not be dead. It will be just it will be alive but paralyzed. So why does it do that? Because if it's dead, it can rot and something will happen. But if it's alive, it will remain fresh, and it's like fresh meat for the babies, rich in protein. So that's how the pompilids do.
I had a question, Chinmay. Sorry.
Yeah.
Do we have any examples of a tarantula hawk wasp which feeds on tarantulas in India? Yeah. Have we discovered any species of wasp that?
Yeah, they are there. There are quite there, like lots of records from Mumbai region, actually. They have been taking out Mumbai, I forgot the name of the tarantula that's specifically there around the Mumbai region. But yeah, tarantula hawk wasps are there. There are there in India.
Okay, thank you.
And yeah, spacids, spacids generally mean thread waisted wasps, but in that mudhoppers are those create mud nest made of mud. You can see them around your house as well. Even these guys, they take in spiders, spider wasps, and store them in their mud cavity and then lay an egg so that the young will eat them fresh. There have been records I heard from a friend that once what happened is he opened this the mud dauber nest and he found the spider. Like it got rusticated after like 3 weeks. For 3 weeks, it was incapacitated, but it was still alive. But after 3 weeks, it was able to walk. So within basically 3 weeks, it will be devoured by the larvae, and it will pupate and become big. So, and yeah, there are also parasitoid flies and wasps. Like you can see this small, like this is a ichneumon wasp grub which has attacked a cyclosa, a trash line or beaver. So there are even parasitoid flies and wasps which are predate on spiders. Not basically predate, but parasitoid, yeah, they kill spiders. So bigger predatory insects like this mantis, and this is a MS in a like specific subfamily of assassin bugs called thread-legged assassins. They are real experts in invading spiders. Through their like thin thread legs, they mimic the movement of prey by getting onto a spider web. So when the spider approaches thinking that there is a prey, they will just attack and kill it. So these are expert spider hunters. What is the MSNA or thread-legged assassins, and other bigger predators like frogs, lizards, birds. Yeah, that is common. And yeah, how do spiders grow? So spiders, they are not basically like us. They do not like we leave our skin, like our dry skin just falls off, and some new spider needs to be discovered. Like if you at all find a new spider, it always depends upon the pedipalps and the female epigynum. And yeah, every species will have a different structure of epigynum and palps. So these palps are the ones which determine which species a spider actually belongs to. And spider mating, like there are many different strategies of spider mating. Like in peacock spiders, you can find males dance and put on elaborate displays. Even there is a particular peacock spider which will actually make sound. It will actually sing to woo the female. So yeah, in general, in even other solticids, spiders actually, solticid males actually, or jumping spiders male, put on a display of dancing, running around, just to make the female receptive to mate. And in other spiders, the male just goes and insert its palps into the epigynum or the female reproductive tract, and it just sacrifices itself to the female once its job is done. For example, for this include most of the cobweb spiders and our ornamental tree trunk spider. The male ultimately becomes a sacrifice for the female and for the betterment of his kind. Okay. Some spider, like there is some particular fishing spiders which actually bring nuptial gifts so that the female does not feed on him once the mating is over and then mate. And there is one particular running crab spider species which will actually go and bite the female, paralyze her, mate, and then run away. Yeah, these are few strategies. And you can see this, like this is a pair of long-jawed orb beavers mating. And this is a hylus or what semi-cubrus, heavy-bodied jumper, male and female. The beauty of in jumpers is like in sometimes when the female, any spider before its final molt cannot mate. So it will not reach its sexual maturity. So what the male does is it finds a female which is just, which will reach its sexual maturity, which is about to reach its sexual maturity after molting, and he will guard it. So that once she molts and she is ready, he'll be the one to mate. So this is seen in solticids like this one. This is what this guy is doing here. He is guarding the female from other males so that he get the right to mate. Here you can see a clever golden orb beaver male. You can see the significant change in sexual dimorphism. The female is almost more than 8 times the size of the male. So in any common scenario, if at all the male approaches the female and tries to mate, he will be a good snack. So this clever guy, what will do is whenever she has a catch in her mouth or whenever she is molting, they approach, mate, and get away. Otherwise, she will become a snack. And parental care is quite seen in lots of genera. In most spider females are really good moms, and they will generally protect their eggs even with their lives sometimes. And never go out for feeding. They just stay there till the egg hatches. And after two molts of the spiderling, they will always be there till one or two molts. So different spiders, like you can see this wool spider mom carrying her egg sac behind, crab spider guarding her egg sac, cribellate or beaver guarding her egg sac, even female lynx guarding her egg sac, Bretus mom, like she will build a beautiful cage like a boundary which the babies won't cross. So they are quite protective. And there are some genera of spiders, like the family Eresidae, and in that the genus Sardisonorium, those are called social spiders. In social spiders, parent care and care is such that the female itself will just enclose itself with the egg sac in its nest, and once the babies are out, the babies will feed on the female, and she will become sacrifice for the new generation. That is called matrophagy. Matrophagy is mother eating. So the babies will actually feed on the mother to survive and grow. And taxonomy. Okay, what is taxonomy? Science of classifying creatures. So how do you go about it? Look out for all the features in an organism. Compare this feature with similar organism. Basically, if I want to wind it up a bit, it's like how do you know what a chicken is different from a crow? If at all first time you see a chicken and a crow, you know it's different, but you don't know the name. But once you get familiarized after 2-3 times, you know the name. That's taxonomy. So both are birds, you can see they have feathers, but this is black, this isn't. And that's basically taxonomy. Taxonomy in spiders is based on morphology, genetics, and phylogeny studies. Phylogeny is still not in wide scale, but generally now it's based on morphology and generally morphology as of now. And spider taxonomy, as I said earlier, where does the spider stand in the animal kingdom? So what is the specific place of the spider in the animal kingdom is, we will get to know. So spiders are, why does the spider belong to Animalia? Why does the spider belong to Animalia and not plant? Because they are multicellular and eukaryotic, hence they belong to Animalia and they are not plants. So, and they have jointed legs and hence they belong to Arthropoda. So Arthropoda, the character of this phylum is jointed legs. So, and they have appendages called chelicerae, hence they belong to the subphylum Chelicerata. And spiders also have an extra appendage called pedipalps or palps, hence they belong to the class Arachnida. And spiders have the ability to spin silk, hence they belong to the order Araneae. So you get the eight-legged thing around in the subphylum itself in Chelicerata, almost you get all the eight-legged ones. Then by what seeing the characters which are similar and which are not, finally we arrive at the order Araneae. There you have, as said in the water spiders thing slide. They are eight-legged, air-breathing, terrestrial arthropods equipped with chelicerae and have the ability to spin silk. Arthropods, because they belong to the order Arthropoda, then they belong to Arthropoda phylum, and then Chelicerata subphylum Chelicerata, and finally Araneae, because they have the ability to spin silk. So now I think it makes sense why I have given that definition for a spider. And primordially, the order Araneae has two suborders, that is Mesothale and Opisthothale. And so Mesothale are like really primordial spiders, like all spiders started on the ground as like ground crawling creatures, ground crawling arthropods. And like if you see this primitive beautiful spider, you can see it's the whole of its abdomen is, the segmentation is in segmentation, you can see in insects and all, but in spiders it's all fused, and other spiders it's all fused and you cannot see, though they are there inside, as it's fused you cannot see. But in this suborder Mesothelae, you can see, you can clearly see the segmentation. So these are really primitive spiders. And under the suborder Mesothelae, you have family Liphistidae, and the most primitive characteristics is the segmented abdomen, and the spinnerets are present in the middle of the abdomen. Spinnerets are the silk producing organs which are generally present at the end of the abdomen, but in this they are present at the beginning, at the middle. So this makes them like, through fossil records, if you see the fossils and all, these go quite back, around 400 million years something. So like these are like living fossils, and they haven't changed much from their openings. They are like, these are present in Burma. None have been described from India as of now. Hope someone describes them from the Northeast. Like they may potentially be there actually. Suborder Ophistothelae. Ophistothelae is like, they are all the modern spiders and have abdomen segmentation. Don't have abdomen segmentation, and spinnerets are placed at the end of the abdomen. And under suborder Ophistothelae, we have Myclomorphae and Arenomorphae. In infraorder Myclomorphae, we have all the tarantulas and all the comparatively primitive spiders compared to the normal spiders. So these are comparatively primitive. They Myclomorphae actually translates to shrew-shaped spiders, and they are generally most of them are ground dwelling, some genus or some taxons are arboreal. They contain all the tarantulas, trapdoors, moth spiders, etc., etc. All of them, like all the primitive looking ones. And what is the specific feature of this Myclomorphae? They are quite sturdily built. All eyes have been clubbed on a prominent tubercule. Males with two simple palps, and they have, this is very important, two pair of book lungs. If at all you get a ventral shot of a spider, you can easily tell if it's Myclomorphae or Arenomorphae based on this character. And these again, fangs point straight down and don't cross each other. And in this Myclomorphae, these are these are Atrax and Hadronychia of Australia are medically significant spiders. Like they are known to cause significant human harm, like almost even death if you get bitten by these things, Atrax, the genera Atrax and Hadronych. Those are called mouse spiders, I believe, in Australia, and their venom is of real medical significance. And that's for Australia. In India, we have the genus Poecilotheria and other genera of tarantulas and trapdoors and all. They give a really good bite, a nasty bite, which will have some inflection, which will inflict in some damage, not significant. But if at all you are allergic to that venom, you are in trouble. But not to the case as in death caused by the Atrax and Hadronychia, but it will cause significant pain and other things. But these are all the Oriental tarantulas are capable of biting well. But in the New World, around the Americas, the spiders there, they have utricating hair. They generally don't want to bite people, and they just leave their utricating hair, which cause allergies when inhaled or when they come in contact with the skin. And this is the Theraphosidae or Poecilotheria or ornamental tarantula. These are the examples of infraorder Myclomorphae. You can see the peacock or ornamental tarantula here. One of the, like, these are astray in the pet trade. Like, they are really wanted in the pet trade because of the beautiful coloration. And they are quite rare even in the natural habitats. And smugglers are still, like, it's quite mandatory that even though you can find males and females in the pet trade, to restock the genetic code, like periodically some tarantulas need to be lifted from the wild so that inbreeding does not occur. So still it's quite rampant that people try to smuggle this, and it's illegal to own these spiders. And there is a Diploruda pursuive spider. These are other examples, and armored trapdoor spiders. Like you can see that they are full robust built, and all their eyes, if you observe, are clubbed upon a single tubercule. They are not what spread. They are just clubbed upon a single tubercule. Okay. And you have the infrared arachnomorphae. Like these are all the everyday spiders we find around. So these are short-lived and found to occupy a variety of habitats. Like arachnomorphae spiders, you can find even on top of Mount Everest to even the Death Valley. They are all there. These spiders have a single pair of hook lungs, yeah, as I said, and sometimes replaced by trachea. Male pulps are quite complicated. Eyes present in typical arrangement on the carapace. Fangs pointing forward and cross each other like a pinching action. I will tell you that, yeah. So this is the actual classification, as said, in what using order Mesothel and Opisthothel. But the another alternate classification for this is suborder Lepidognatha and Orthognatha. The Mygalomorphae, as said here, fangs point forward down and do not cross each other. So they belong to Lepidognatha, because it's like a forking action. They do not pinch, like they go only forward and backward. Like, so they belong to Lepidognatha, and all Arachnomorphae spiders belong to Orthognatha because their jaws move in a pinching action. Yeah, as mentioned, Mesothel and Mygalomorphae spiders. Okay, this is an alternate classification. Then comes classification of Arachnomorphic spiders. So how do we classify Arachnomorphic spiders? For classifying these spiders, the necessary thing to watch are the eye arrangement, morphology, habitat behavior, and web structure, if at all there is a web. So eye arrangement is quite enough for generally most of the cases for spiders to place them in their respective families. But further down for genus, there are like many of these spiders can be directly placed to their genera by observing their peculiar morphology and behavior, or even color, or yeah, morphology is enough. And like some specific, when they are like distinctly colored or not cryptic, you can directly tell the species of a spider. If at all a spider is cryptic, you need to just get a specimen, dissect them, and examine the pulps and the epigyna, pulps of the male and epigyna of the female, to determine the species. This is a typical, you can see the eye arrangements and the different spiders. Eye arrangement of the different families of spiders present. This is something you must always know. The eyes on the either side of the spider are called lateral eyes, and the eyes in the middle are called median eyes. Upper row eyes are called posterior eyes, and the below row eyes are called anterior eyes. So AME, if someone gives the term AME, means that's anterior median eyes, and PLE means posterior lateral eyes. So these are the short terms used for the eyes thing. So it's better to know this classification. Jumping spiders, like these are the most diverse, like more than 13,000 species of jumping spiders are present now. And they are really diverse, and they occupy a wide range of habitats. I'm just I will just go through the common spiders that I find around here in Bangalore, and some of the like beautiful ones which I like to include. So this is the most common spider we can find around Bangalore, this one especially, Plexippus baculi. If not Bangalore, whole of Karnataka, I believe, because I have seen them quite everywhere. They are a synanthric, and even like synanthric means they can be seen associated with humans. They are found in human habitations, and they are also found in the wild, even on trees, under rocks, you name it, they are there. And that's Plexippus baculi. pantropical jumping spider, and the other guy here is Plexippus petersi. But the males, you can see, like, just by seeing this, if you can compare the eyes, there is, this belongs to the family Salticidae, and they are called jumping spiders. You can compare the eyes, yeah, so it matches, so you know which family it is. But and by seeing this distinct coloration, which is not seen in any other spiders, you can, so you can know that this is Plexippus paeculi and this is petersi. But the problem in this one is you cannot tell about the females. Why? Because they are cryptic and both the females look alike. And how do you know which is paeculi and which is petersi? If at all there is a male nearby in around her nest, you will know that is paeculi. If paeculi is there, it's paeculi. If petersi is there, it's petersi. Because yeah, only they know their females, right? If you actually want to know, you want to dissect the female and know the epigynum to get it. And here you can see it is, this female is actually eating another jumping spider of the genus Menemerus. So this is an example of arenophagy, because a Plexippus is eating a Menemerus, which are two different species. And yeah, this is called the common wall jumper Menemerus pivitatus, and this is a male and this is a female. These are also quite common among households and even parks and all. This is a typical arboreal spider, and generally in its natural habitat, it's found on tree bark and on rocks and all. In house, it can be found on walls, wandering around. There is another genre of, this is actually not quite significantly seen in our water, synanthropic or around human habitats, but this one, this Menemerus, I think is fulvus, is quite seen around Bangalore. Actually speaking, I just think this is fulvus, but I'm not sure, someone needs to open it up and confirm. But this is more common compared to this in Bangalore, as in, and this is typically found in all households. And this is Asaria sedanceni, this is a beautiful male and a female. Just you can see the coloration of the males, it's quite different, and you will easily know which species it is just by the beautiful coloration of the males. So this is a male and this is a female, Adanson's house jumper. It's again a quite common one around households. And you have our Hylas semicuperus, or heavy bodied jumper male and a female. Like the most of the macro enthusiasts who get into spiders either start with Hylas or with Tilamonia, that is a two-stripe jumper, because these are really, really common. Like if you go to any garden or any green place, they must be there, either of them. So most of the macro enthusiasts will like start the journey into spiders through either Tilamonia or Hylas, and yeah, they're quite beautiful, you can see. And this is Carotus vidus. I don't know if it has a common name, let's name it zebra jumper. Okay, so this is a beautiful male and this is a female. Oh, I forgot to mention one thing, the palps are only like clearly observed once the male spider actually attains maturity, like only after its final or subfinal penultimate or ultimate molt, you can before the penultimate molt, you will not know which is the male and which is the female. They are like subadults. In the subadult form, like in the juvie form, you do not know which is the male and which is the female. Both will be of the same coloration, but in subadult form, male will have a slight bulge in the palps, but the coloration will be same as that of a female. Only when, like most of the times, it has so happened that when we went into the field and photographed, we thought it was a female, but when we reviewed the photos back home, we got to know that, oh, that's a subadult male, because the pedipalps were actually enlarged. But only after the final molt, you get the beautiful coloration of the male. And yeah, this is a female and this is a male, Carotus vidus. Again, like in season, you find loads and loads of them around Bangalore, especially in those Congress plants, Chromalina. Communist plants called Chromalina odorata. This is EPSSP, another commoner, arene or helmeted jumper, another commoner. And Like among the three most beautiful jumpers in Bangalore, this is one of them. Fintella Vitata, a beautiful male and a beautiful female. Just look at the scene. Wow. These are just like one of the most beautiful jumpers. You can see them. See how like this is a female and this is a male, because you can see the palps. The palps are swollen, though small. And even the coloration is quite different, significant percent. And you have like some salticids are really opportunistic, and like they have evolved to mimic ants. And this is like these are quite examples of those ant mimicking salticids or jumping spiders. This is Myrma plata platyloides. This is a male and this is a female. The male, like, it looks like a conjunction of two ants, but a female definitely looks like an ant to the untrained eye. And yeah, they are really, really common around weaver ant nests. They will be just jumping around the colony undetected. They are more of Batesian mimics. They just want to, like, mimic weaver ants because they don't want predators to eat them, because ants don't taste good. So that's why they are mimicking ants. And you know, like the evolution is such that they have evolved, their first pair of legs will constantly be shaking, like the antenna of an ant, no matter how, it's like fake it till you make it. So they have just like evolved to be like ants now. And this will be, this is another species of Myrma arachne, which is mimicking a Camponotus or carpenter ants. So these are generally Batesian mimics. That means that they are not aggressive mimics in the sense they don't want, though they do prey on weaver ants occasionally, but they do not always prey on weaver ants. They use weaver ant mimicry to save themselves from potential predators. And as it stands at the most color, top of the most colorful jumpers of Bangalore, this is Crazy Love Olive, the rainbow jumper. And this is a male and this is a female. This is a subadult. I have no other words. Yeah, just look at this beauty. And we have Sirba. This was the spider I was talking about. In Bangalore, we have around three morph of Sirba males, and all the females like around one morph of female. So we have no idea what is happening. Either it, according to the papers, it's just a single species, but not sure. And we have the, like, if you are into spiders, you would have heard about Portia. Portia is also called the devil spider or the debris spider, but it's known to be a really intelligent spider because it's arenophagic. Though it may occasionally eat insects, but it is known to prey heavily on other spiders. And it's not big, it's quite small, but it's intelligent. It plans its moves and invades the webs of other spiders. And after significant planning, it will plunge on the spider and kill the host. And that's how it does. It's quite an intelligent spider person. And this is Bretas. Both belong to the same tribe. But yeah, Bretas isn't arenophagic and she is just guarding her young. But this is an intelligent cunning one. And we have our link spiders, which are really common and found almost everywhere on plants. You will see that generally India has around 5 genera as of the new book, but 4 of them are quite commonly seen in like everywhere, actually. You have the Hamadryas, the Oxyopis, Hamataliva, and Puseti. Puseti is generally called the green link spider. Because yeah, though it's not green, like there are many other moths, but this is the biggest of the lynxes. And the second biggest is the Hamadryas or the monkey faced one. These both are monkey faced. There is quite a thin line of differentiation between Hamadryas, Hamataliva, and the other one is Taponia. But generally speaking, in Hamadryas, the abdomen is quite long, more than 1.5 times the length of the head. But in Hamataliva, it's quite reduced. And in Taponia, it's Taponia is like a smaller, lighter version of Hematalima and shinier version, actually, to say. Oxypus, you cannot, like, Oxypus is quite common, words because I have nothing to say about it. How do you identify Oxypidae? Like, if you see a spider from afar and it has really spiky appearance because all the oxypids have spiky legs. So just by seeing it from quite afar, you will know that it's a lynx spider because of the spiky appearance. And the eye pattern, in Oxypidae, you will have the eye pattern is like that of, you can see it forms a sort of an hexagon. So an hexagonal eye pattern means it's an oxyped or a lynx spider. And I forgot to tell you, they are called jumping spiders because they are constantly jumping. Not that they cannot run, but they choose to jump more. And jumping spiders, because they have the biggest AMEs, and this enables to have such an awesome vision. It's compatible to that of humans. And they are quite intelligent and cute because of this. And yeah, jumping spiders can jump around more than, like, the record, I believe, is more than 34 times the body length jumping spider jumping. So it's like a 2-meter human jumping like 68 meters. Just imagine. That's the power of hydraulics. And then you have Oxypidae. This is Oxyopus. You have Pusatia. As I said, you can see the eyes form a sort of a hexagon. So, you know, just by seeing that, you know, it's Oxypidae or lynx spider, or just by the thorny or pricky like hairy legged spider, means you will know it's an Oxypidae or lynx spider. Why were they called lynx spiders is because the one who nailed this thought that they hunt like a cat. And of course they do, like, when, once they spot a prey, they pounce on it like a cat. So I don't know why they didn't call it cat spider, but they have named it lynx spider. Yeah, it's okay. And we have wool spiders. They were named so because they take down prey by going after them and hunting them like wolves. Not in a group, but single. So wool spiders are, oxypids are all like arboreal. All of them are arboreal. Like, as far as I know, none of them are known to nest on ground and on ground, but all of them tend to nest above ground and stay above ground. Occasionally they do come down, it's not like that, but they always tend to be up on the plants and all. Lycosidae, on the other hand, wool spiders, they are ground dwellers, predominant ground dwellers. And we have like many beautiful genera, like Lycosidae, it's quite hard to ID Lycosids because many of them quite look alike, and you need, it's quite hard to ID. But this is a really common one called funnel web spider or Hippasa. The genus is Hippasa. You would have seen lots of funnels going around in the, like, after monsoons, you find all those funnel webs going in the ground, on the ground lot in large numbers. This is the culprit of it. This is a wool spider of the genus Hippasa. Except Hippasa, like, except a few genera, most of them, they do not construct webs. And they are just free dwelling and, when they want to retreat, they create a small silken retreat among rocks and stay there. Otherwise, they are just free roaming and prowling, hunting prey. And yeah, you can see wool spiders are real good mothers. As this spider, you can see the female carrying her egg sac, and after the eggs hatch, you can see the female is carrying her young ones. They do so for like one or two molts, and after that, all the babies will disperse like that. Before some two molts, they will still be attached to the female's abdomen. And like it's quite an amazing sight when to see this at night. You can see all the tiny eye shines and the eye shine of this happening due to the torchlight. And at night, yeah, these guys are quite easy to spot due to the eye shine because they have real big PMEs, posterior median eyes. Ah, yeah, you will. I will show you the eye arrangement. Leucocyte, yeah, you can see this pretty eyes here. Yeah. They have a reflective layer behind them called tapetum, similar to that of cats and all. And that enables them to have good night vision, which in turn enables them to prowl and locomote at night and catch prey. And these are the small eyes. This is a typical wolf spider arrangement, large PLEs and small anterior eyes, small row of anterior eyes. And depending upon the size and the small changes in the arrangement and the shape of the face, you will know which genus the wolf spider belongs to. And we have wandering spiders. It's easy to get confused between Lycosidae or wolf spiders and wandering spiders. It's just that the difference is like in wolf spiders, you have the posterior median eyes, which are quite significant and big. But in a wandering spider, they are not of a significant size. And even the AMEs are almost of equal length. They form a trapezium. So once you see that, you should know that this is a wandering spider. They are also called wandering wolf spiders, actually. And the eyes are like the face of these guys are, if you can see, almost flat compared to wolves, which have a significant amount of build. So even from afar, you can also spot this due to the eye shine. But upon closer inspection, you will know these are wandering spiders due to this eye arrangement. And this is a wolf spider due to this eye arrangement. And these all belong to the genus Tanais. And there are many other genera, but this is the most common genus you can see around. Genus is Tanais. And herbivores, this I think many of you will be familiar with because they built a typical orb web that comes to our head if at all we think of spiders. So this is a Neoscona or a barn herbivore, barn spider. And it's really common, like synanthric and found around human dwellings. The beauty of this Neoscona or this herbivore is that the beauty of herbivores is that at night, they are active at night. They are nocturnal, not diurnal. So at night, at the evening time, they come out from their hiding place and start to build the web. And after building the web, if at all they catch their prey, it's fine. If not, they will just they'll just consume the whole of the web and go again back to sleep. Like they reuse the web. So they just consume whole of the web and sleep and again weave it the next night. But if at all for consecutive days, it remains hungry, then some of these herbivores will leave it from the morning, but with one of their legs attached so that they will know if any prey is caught, then they will attack and kill it. So that, yeah, it's their strategy. And this is Neoscona. This is quite a cryptic genus. Genus is not so cryptic, but the species are cryptic. Like you cannot easily tell which species it belongs to just by seeing the outer thing. But you will know it's the genus Neoscona because they build these orb webs and they are quite hairy. And the genus Arenas aren't quite hairy. And you will now know why this is called the kidney or beaver, because you can see the kidney shape. The common name of this is kidney or beaver or Arenas mitificus. And this is the one that is present in the poster. But this is diurnal and nocturnal. It doesn't eat its web. If at all it's full, it will not even weave its web. It's not a recycler like Neoscona. But one of the most significant thing, where is that? About this thing, about this spider is this beautiful sac. If at all you see an orb web and at any of the corners you find silken retreat like this in a covered leaf, like a curled leaf, you know it's Araenis beetle, because no other spiders, as per my observation, do this. So even if it's an abandoned web, and if you find an orb web, and at the one of the corners of the orb web you find this kind of silken retreat with a curled leaf, you know who was there. So that's Araenis. And what Canis, Araenis, yeah, Gastrocantha or the spiny, Gastrocantha geminata or the spiny backed orb beaver, it's quite a common one. You would have encountered them. The use of these spines, they say, is to deter the parasitoid wasp, but I really don't. It works because I have seen lots of them with parasitoid eggs on them. I don't know. I don't know why they have about these spines, as they are not working if it is for inhibiting parasitoid attacks. Then you have Paravixia. Like, this is one of the biggest orb weavers, like really sticky web. You will easily know, like, one of the bulkiest orb weavers there around. And again, active at night. And this is Eriovixia, another kind of orb weaver. And simply speaking, this is quite big, and it typically, you know, it's Paravixia by this triangle shaped abdomen. And the eye arrangement, it's not quite a necessity, but just by seeing the triangle shaped abdomen and what sturdy build, you can know it's a Paravixia. It's quite a big spider, around 5 centimeters around. So as around 5 centimeters in length, and you have Eriovixia. These are quite small spiders. How can you ID them? Is their abdomen looks like Modaka or what? Pyramid. You can see pyramid. It's like a pyramid or a cone. So once you see if their abdomen is like a pyramid or a cone, then you know it belongs to the genus Eriovixia. And next you have the trash line orb beavers or the genus Cyclosa. And if you have found large orb webs and you see all the trash in the middle and you thought like this is useless, nothing is there, but actually this is the strategy of a spider of the genus Cyclosa. These strengthened structures are called stabilimentum, these extra structures. Nobody actually knows why do they do it, but there are many speculations. These Cyclosa are known to, the trash line orb weavers are known to build these beautiful structures around, in their webs, in the middle, especially in the middle, and sometimes even lay their eggs, like camouflaged in the dirt. So, to be honest, it provides a good camouflage for the spider, especially in this case per se, but in other cases, I have no clue. Then we have this genus called Ortgarius. Ortgarius is the common name of Ortgarius is the bola spider. And why is called the bola spider? You can see this action happening here. The bola spider, a really typical kind of unique kind of hunting strategy this uses. It will drop droplets of sticky stuff, sticky silk attached to a strand, and start swaying it around in circles, so that this sticky silk also has pheromones which mimics the female moth of a certain species. So when that is spread around, the males get attracted to it and come in the range of this when it's spinning it around. So, and when it comes in contact with a droplet, it will just pull it in and eat it. So it's quite a unique way of capturing prey, and it's called the bola spider. Around three species are reported from India. These are two of them. And this is, I forgot that. Cyclosa, as I said, it's quite characterized by that in the middle of their webs. And you have the tent web spiders or Pseudophora. This like if you all find like law many what fences and many other compounds like with grills covered with webs which in the middle tend to have like what a tent like structure, and they are like colonial, like lots of it's like the whole compound of the whole railing will be covered with this, then this is the culprit. This genus, this is the tent web spider. It can be easily identified by the what the tent like web, and this you can see this green structure are its eggs actually. So called orb weavers. Some employ different strategies. Like this is not at all what orb web, but it's a tent web. And this actually doesn't even weave a web, but it uses different strategies. But there are other features which like the eye arrangement and other things as such which place this under this particular family. And we have Argiope. Argiope is our signature spider, and no need of introduction because they use this kind of like the sublimentum. They build is in the form of signature, so that's why their common name is signature spider, and they are really quite common around around human habitations. Why do these guys do it? It's definitely not for camouflage because they are not cryptic and they are like bright in color, and it like some theories say that it's in order to make them look big. And some theories say that it's to reflect the sunlight, and in UV it looks like colorful to a butterfly. And even other theories say that it's to warn bats and even butterflies, sorry, not butterflies, birds from crashing into their webs. You have the giant, then you have the giant web, what is this? Giant wood spider, Nephila philippes, this like, as of now, we know Nephila philippes, and we had another one called the black one called Nephila coolie. But recent studies have shown that all the black ones are actually Nephila philippes itself, the golden orb weavers, and the black ones are just the melanistic forms of this. So yeah, these are one of the like the largest spiders, arenamorphic spiders in India. With the Paravixia, I believe. So, but yeah, these are the largest, and they build significantly huge webs and need no introduction. And this is our ornamental tree trunk spider. One of like, how do you spot this? These are like really cryptic when they are found on the tree trunk. But once, if at all you find an or sort of an orb web which spreads along the trunk, the circumference of the trunk, then you know this is the ornamental tree trunk spider. And yeah, like. In this, the males are known to sacrifice themselves for the female, like after mating, not in others. Okay, and this is Poltis. Okay, Poltis is called the twig mimic spider, but due to its awkward position in which I found it, you know it's quite significant. But these are all nocturnal, and in the morning they are really, really cryptic. Unless and until you know the position of their webs at night, it's really, really hard to find them in the day. And they just like, this is called the tree stump spider because it looks like a stump. If at all, if I were to find it on a stump of a tree, then I wouldn't have recognized it. But it was on a compound, so I got to know its qualities. Even like, they are also twig mimics, expert mimics actually. But unless and until at night, if you see them on the twig, sorry, on the web, you will never know where they are. And their general habitat preference is around thorny bushes and all, so that they blend in well. This is Arachnura or the scorpion-tailed spider. These are all quite distinct. You can just tell ornamental tree trunk spider, Herania multipunta is the only species in India. Like you cannot tell it's Herania sp or anything as such. This, as of now, is the only species. Argiope, there are many other species, but Nephila golden you can easily tell. Arachnura, like these genera can easily be told apart just by their morphology and appearance. Even like if at all the spider, you cannot find the spider. And if at all you find a circular web or web wrapped around the tree trunk, then you can easily know that here Renia multipuncta is here or was there. Like sometimes it is possible to know which spider was there just based on the observing the web structures that they leave behind. Like even in the signature spider, you find the zigzag patterns and the spider isn't there. You know, oh, this is the work of a signature spider and no other spider does that. Even in Cyclosa and in Gastrocantha, one of the most beautiful things is it forms an off web, but the external support structure is a triangle, a big triangle. So if at all you find an orb web in the middle, but a big triangle supporting like supporting strands, then you know it's a Gastrocantha was there. So like through observations, you will know, like it is possible to know which, sometimes it is possible to know which genus or sometimes even species has built this particular web or was there. And we have the long-jawed orb weavers. Bangalore has five. Now I think I am showing you 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, so this is Tetragnatha. Why they are called long-jawed orb weavers? They are again orb weavers, but they have really significantly long jaws and their jaws go forward and bend in. So it appears as if they have four jaws. So it's called Tetragnathidae or four jawed. And Tetragnatha is this, and it's what, a leaner version and found on twigs and all. And it's quite long. Like compared to Araneidae, you can easily differentiate Tetragnathidae based on their really long jaws and their significantly bulged up eyes. And yeah, of course, their legs are even really, really long compared to other Araneids. So the Tetragnathidae, this is Tetragnatha. This is Lukaji. Lukaji has, this is due to guanine. The silvery color is basically due to the pigment guanine. Pigment or color, I don't know. Guanine crystals. Okay. And this is Tylorida. How do you differentiate all this? It's quite simple. Tylorida, it's the abdomen is quite big and it's almost like boxish. But in Tetragnatha, it's more of a cylinder like a pipe. In Lukaji, Lukaji generally have this silverish pattern on their back, and you can see it's like this. So you can say Lukaji. In Apatometa, I love to call it the KTM spider because of the coloration. Apatometa festigata is the most commonly known, is the known species which is quite common around. So confuse it with Lukaji anyway because of this distinct coloration. And you have heckled orb weavers. As far as you know, we like all of the genera have chelicerae and have venom glands in them. But this Ulaboridae, this particular family, has no venom glands. So how do they hunt their prey? How do they do it is, like when, if at all, prey falls in there, they generally rapidly wrap the prey in their silk. Then inject into that packet their digestive enzymes. These digestive enzymes just make the whole prey into liquid. So then they'll just slurp it up. Here there is no venom injected. They are really harmless. And common heckled orb weaver, I believe, is Zosis geniculata. If you see any, what? sewage chamber.
Sewage.
But pardon?
అదే సీవేజ్ అంద
సీవేజ్ పైప్ యా చరండి సీవేజ్ పైప్స్ ఇఫ్ ఎట్ ఆల్ యూ ఫైండ్ ఎనీ సీవేజ్ పైప్ ఆర్ ఈవెన్ అండర్ ఇన్ టర్మైట్ మౌంట్స్ ఎనీవేర్ అస్ సచ్ యూ విల్ ఫైండ్ దిస్ డిస్టింక్ట్ ఆర్బ్ వెబ్ స్టిక్కీ ఆర్బ్ వెబ్ అండ్ సమ్టైమ్స్ ఈవెన్ దిస్ ఇస్ ఇట్స్ ఎగ్జాక్ట్ దట్స్ జోసిస్ జెనికులాటా అండ్ ఇట్స్ ఫౌండ్ ఆల్ అరౌండ్ ది వరల్డ్ ఇట్స్ క్వైట్ స్ప్రెడ్ డ్యూ టు హ్యూమన్స్ ఇట్స్ యాక్చువల్లీ నేటివ్ టు న్యూజిలాండ్ ఆర్ ఆస్ట్రేలియా ఐ బిలీవ్ బట్ నౌ ఇట్స్ ఫౌండ్ ఆల్ అరౌండ్ ది వరల్డ్ And when I say spiders are opportunities, this is what I mean when they are opportunities. See, this is in a water purifier, and I saw a pair of Ulaboras in it, one and two. and they have made their web on a water purifier. Why they are called heckled herbivores? Because their herbivore is more like silky, sticky-ish, rather than like when you see in other herbivores, it's like plain and clear, but it appears more silkish and what white, you know what I mean? It's more heckled, so it's called a heckled herbivore. And these are all venomless. This is Miagramus, or the twig mimic ones. Best time to spot them, like you can easily spot them because of this typical structure in which they rest. And you have this Iptiotis SP. This is a really awesome spider, actually. Even present in India, this particular species, what it does is it prepares a slingshot to capture its prey. What it just brings in a triangular, like a slingshot, a triangular trap with full pressure. It brings it in, holds it, just like you have a catapult or a slingshot, how you pull it back like an arrow, and it will have some threads around to sense if there is prey nearby. If at all it senses a prey nearby, it will just release the spider web, and it will go and wrap around, just like when you take a catapult and pull it back and hit to any of the target. Just like that, this spider works like hunts. So it will brings in a web structure behind and pulls it with tension, and if at all it senses movement, it releases it, and this causes the spider web to go at full speed. Like this is the second most fastest movement of spiders, I believe, when it releases, that will go and entrap the prey. And you have crab spiders. These are the most common ones because of they can be found on flowers and on top of plants, and they are really good ballooners. If at all given an opportunity, will balloon away really quickly. And yeah, many a times it has happened so that we were trying to photograph it and we just turned and looked back, it was not there. It was around 2 meters away, ballooning away. So yeah, these are crab spiders, and this is a Thomisus SP, easily told by this horn like tubercles on its head, which is observed. And here also you can see the sexual dimorphism. The male is like six to seven times smaller than the female. And another one is Runcinia. Runcinia is again a commoner during the seasons, but Indoxysticus, another ground crab spider. This, even if you do not see Thomisus, you will see Indoxysticus inside your house, because they are quite adaptable, and I don't know, I have found them significantly everywhere. Even sometimes I have found them inside my scooter, my vehicle and all. I don't know how do they land there, but they are quite common. And you have small boomies. The thing about crab spiders is they have really quick acting venom, because they have and good here can I see, like, I don't know if I can show it to you, but if the front two legs of a crab spider are equipped with thorns, because they want to catch, they generally, like most of the genera generally rest on flowers, and they want to catch the pollinators and prevent them from flying. So like you need good grip and strength, and most like many a times in the field when we see a butterfly just stuck on a plant, you must know that there is a crab spider holding it down. And yeah, like it will fit all its struggling. Yeah, it has many times happened, and you cannot even see the crab spider, it will be that small, but the grip strength and the venom is quite powerful and potent, that within a few minutes if a butterfly, which is significantly bigger compared to a genus like Bomis, will get subdued and will just collapse. And this is Comaricus. This is from the Western Ghats gene, and this is mostly the Western Ghats, not around Bangalore. Bomis is common, and we have Amasia. This is an example of aggressive mimicry, because Amasia It exclusively preys on beaver ants, and nest near it will stay near beaver ant nests. What it does is it is like a ninja. It will cling and hang on from a thread above the pathway of a beaver ant, and once at like it will come down, and the pack looks like that of a beaver ant. If at all another beaver ant approaches it, thinking to be a beaver ant, and it's like if that ant is quite isolated from the rest, it will just grab it by the neck and go up. Like it will just extort or kidnap the thing and kill it and eat. So this is an example of aggressive mimicry. Mysia, it's no, yeah, that is known for that. Why I have included Mismena wattia is this spider, crab spider, is known to change colors from white to yellow and yellow to white, depending upon its placement on the flower. And no color in between, but just white to yellow and yellow to white. And yeah, crab spiders are like many, like it's thought that many crab spiders can like change their colors in UV and even on flowers, like yellow to white. But the recorded one is this. But there are also other records of Thomas's doing that. But this actual record and scientific paper, you will get on this Mismena wattia. And there are other running crab spiders. This is quite common around household, like again in season, not always. Why they are called crab spiders? Because of the typical position. You do not even want, like, you can easily differentiate the crab spider from any other family because of their position. You can see all of them are holding, like, all of them are taking their arms, like, in the resemblance of a crab. So that's how you know they are crab spiders. That's why they get that name called crab spiders. And what next? Yeah, Philodromidae are called running crab spiders. They are quite significantly different. One of the best differentiating factors is, if you can see, in crab spiders, the first pair of leg is larger than the second pair. But in Philodromidae, the second pair is the largest. And you have huntsmen or the sporacids or the giant crab spiders because of their position. These three genera are really common around, wherever you go. Under rocks and all, you find heteropoda under rock and bark. But on arboreal, things like Nathopalistes and Oleus are quite arboreal. How do you differentiate? Like, the eye pattern is significantly different. And sometimes people tend to get confused between Oleus and Gnatho. The difference here is, if you can observe carefully, the ALEs, anterior lateral eyes, if you can see, are the biggest. Anterior lateral eyes are the biggest, and they are procurved. These are small and it's procurved. So if at all you see that and white things, ignoring the white things just by this row, you know it's Gnathopalistes. But in Oleus, it's not so. The AM is the middle eyes will be larger in Oleus. In Heteropoda, the eye arrangement is significantly different and the color is different and the habitat itself is also different and it is a ground dweller, generally a ground dweller. Oleus and Gnathopalistes both are arboreal. And no house is complete without cobweb spiders, actually, especially this one, the red house spider called Nesticotes rufipes. You must and should have seen these guys inside your house. If not, please do observe. And these are also sometimes common, the genus Acarnia. Why are they called cobweb spiders? Because they build irregular. It's as simple as that. And this is a beautiful spider called the Nihonimia mudula, because the characteristics of Nihonimia and Parasteatoda, both the genera, is that in their webs, in their irregular webs, if you see an irregular web like a tent web, but in the middle somewhere you see a curled up leaf and inside that there is a spider, you know it's Nihonimia or Parasteatoda. As I said, like some spider webs are really, really typical, so you can just narrow it down directly to the genus or species. you have Myotypa. In the sense, like the bite and like the complications of this one hasn't been reported from India. So it is known to, like, if at all allergy, if at all someone is allergic, it is known to cause intense pain, rashes, and nausea as such. But no fatalities or like what, like if at all lactrodectus or a widow spider bites you, it sets off a series of symptoms. That whole thing is called lactrodectism. That lactrodectism hasn't actually been perfectly recorded from India, not yet. So, and generally they are really docile. They don't want to come and bite you. Even if you disturb it, the first thing it will do is run away and hide. These are really shy spiders. Like it, these guys used to nest inside my vehicle. And if at all I shine a bit of my torchlight, they used to run inside. So they are really docile and pretty harmless if not you force it to bite you. And you have the beautiful white Asia or the mirror spider. And depending upon the stress upon it, you will see the significant change in the pattern of the mirrors in its back. And it will, like, in the calm situation, it will just, the whole back will be silverish. And it is also called the mirror spider, mirror foot spider. Yeah, it's a beautiful spider, not common. It's found along the forested paths, farmers' guards, I mean, of the Western Ghats. And this is Steatoda. Steatoda is also called the false widow spider. False widow spider because of its resemblance. But I will say that Lactrodectus geometricus or the brown widow is more common than Steatoda. Because brown widow is synanthropic. As I said, how they are known to build webs under cars, under vehicles. So, and if at all you, if a female just builds a web with its babies, then the babies can spread to lots of places. That's how they spread throughout the world. Like, if not throughout the world, throughout India, that's because they are synanthropic, because they spread with humans. They are found around human habitations, I believe. Okay. So, Steatoda is a false widow spider, and this is Colesoma. Colesoma is like an ant mimic theridate. Not really common, but yeah, you can find them. This is quite hard family to find around. Like this, I have seen only once. I have seen this only in a park in Mysore, and so this I have not found in large numbers. This family is called Linifidae. Easily absorbed by the sheet web. That's why they're called sheet web spiders. You can find the sheet web. This web structure is completely, it's more like, it's really tightly packed and a single layer of web. So it's quite easy to differentiate them from the rest of the genera species or anything as such. And you have nursery web spiders, or what else you call them? Fishing spiders, yeah, it's called Pisauridae, and they have a typical eye arrangements, and they are quite big spiders. These are known to, like, some of the genus occupy waterfront habitats and fish, they eat fish and tadpoles by catching them by running on water. So nursery web spiders are like, the genus, the Perennithis, is quite common around Bangalore. Other than that, others are not so. This is Nilus, one of the biggest pisaurid that can be found in India. This is Dendrolycosa, I believe. And yeah, they have slight, slight change in morphology and a tad bit change in their eye arrangement, with which you can easily find the genus. So nursery spiders aren't so hard to ID, and they can easily be, like, if at all you find a typical nurse web like this, you will know this was done by a nurse web spider. And if at all you find a large spider walking on water, then you should know it's a fishing spider or pisaurid. you have velvet spiders or Erythridae. These are the ones, yeah, you can, oh, oopsie. This is what I meant by the social, these are called, these are also called social spiders. And these are really cute. If you can see, like, this is quite different. The eyes are present in almost like a perfect square. And they are found in these big colonies in which you can find lots and lots of them. These are one of the what colonials, where, like, they form colonies easily. They are found in social groups. That's why they're called social spiders. And maternal care is found in the matriophagy. The female will enclose itself with its babies, and the babies will feed on the female in this genera itself. Genus is Stegodaphis. The most commonly seen spider this year is Stegodaphis saracinorium. It's quite commonly seen around Bangalore. If at all, like, if you open this, you will know, you will find the spiders. They do not generally come out in the mornings. Only after evening they will be all over these webs. You can find them all scattered. It's quite beautiful. And these sunbirds sometimes tend to nest in these pockets of webs made by the Stegodaphis. And yeah, I've seen it. I don't know if there is like a mutualistic relationship or a commensalistic, but yeah, sunbirds tend to like make nests in these. And you have two trained spiders. These are really, really common on tree barks, on the tree trunks, I mean. Yeah, on the bark, on the trunk. Generally of the genus Hersia. You can say why they are called the two-tailed spiders, because of the really huge long spinnerets. India has three genera, Murisia, Hercilia, and Neotama. Murisia is quite a rare one. It's quite rare, but generally what you find around is Hercilia. And yeah, it's a really common spider, actually. And yeah, what can I say? The most distinct feature is the long tail. And again, arboreal, found on tree trunks. If in your house, it will be found on walls. And we have cellar spiders. No house is again complete without cellar spiders. Either of the species, I have five species of them. This is like, you cannot confuse yourself with any other cellar spider with this one. Cellar spiders are also called daddy longlegs, but cellar spider is a good name, like a better name for this. This is Crossopisa leoni or box cellar spider, because the abdomen is in the form of a box. So you cannot confuse this with any other genera or species, as this is like a particular character is not found in any other. You can just say this, you can just close your eyes and say this is box cellar spider or Crossopisa leoni. And this this is found around households. These are really small. I believe this is Microfalcus. This belongs to the genus Microfalcus, but I'm not pretty sure. But as this has been reported worldwide and it's synanthropic, I firmly believe this is Microfalcus. And it's really, really small, almost transparent person. And this is Falcus phalangioides carrying her eggs and protecting it. Again, a really common one, cylindrical abdomen, long legs, easily distinguished. And you have the giant cellar spider called Artema atlanta, really huge ones. If you see a really huge one, and generally Artema atlanta will have its exoskeletons or molds around it. So if at all you see a cellar spider with its molds around it, it might just be Artema atlanta. If you can observe, the patterns on its back are also quite different. All of them have different patterns. So again, it's easy to tell this has a different pattern, and even morphology is completely different. These are also called, it's called the giant cellar spider, or even the ball cellar spider, because the abdomen is like a ball. And this is Physocyclus globosus, another really common household spider. If it's none of this, it should be this. That's how I can say. But again, it's how can I differentiate? These are not too small, but medium sized guys with their abdomen is really curved in the sense really curved, I mean. So if you see this, and they have more white like dot white dots on their abdomen, then you know it's physocephalus globosus. And yeah, if at all you do not find nesticots or red house spider or cellar spider, this spider must be there, because otherwise it's not a house. So these are called wall spiders or cobweb spiders, belong to the family Oicobidae or Oisobius or Oisobidae. I don't know the correct pronunciation, but yeah, these are found on every corner. Like you want to say, like, they must be there in at least one corner of your house. Otherwise, it's not a house. It's really synanthropic. In natural habitat, I have never seen this. But this one in particular, I have seen really good at what significantly their foot, like most part of the foot is actually ants, and sometimes even they try to even hunt other spiders as well, though they are small. And the typical wrapping fashion is just awesome. They just go around the prey and wrap it up. We have the net casting spider, Asian Apis. So generally, Asian Apis, what is that? Net casting spider, Deinopidae, have the largest ALIS, or what is that? PMS. They have the largest PMS, or posterior median eyes. These are posterior median eyes. PMS in back row, middle eyes. But in Salticids, it's AMS. AMS are quite reduced here. So these really big eyes are like torch lights. At night, they are more sensitive to light and do not leave even the slightest light. So it helps them hunt at night. And they are called net casting spiders because of their typical, they hunt trigger crosshairs or trigger silks that are go around, and they just hover over a certain silk wad. And if at all they feel any movement going below them, they just catch their net like a fisherman and catch the prey, wrap it up and eat. And the beauty of these spiders is they are really eyes that like every day they regenerate their retina. The retina is regenerated every day. In the morning when they rest, they are really cryptic. If you want to really track down one, you should know where it's nest, like it's building its web and hunting. And also it will not be in the same position, it will be moving. So unless and until in the morning, if it's on an odd substratum, it's near impossible to find this. They are really cryptic and near impossible to find this. They are really cryptic and just look like twigs in the underground. And yeah, first everything was, all these were under Deinopis. Recently a revision was done, and the net casting spiders, which have these tubercules on these eyes, now belong to the genus Asianopis. So it said that all the almost all the net casting spiders of India belong to the genus Asianopis and not Deinopis, because Deinopis doesn't have this tubercule and Asianopis. And you have spitting spiders. Spitting spiders have just 6 eyes, not 8. And their hunting fashion is quite incredible, because they do not build webs and all. But if at all any other spider or any other creature which comes in like in its range, it will spit 2 strands of silk laced with venom at the prey with high speed, and this will just entrap the prey and start to kill it. So that's spitting spider. Spitting spiders are quite common actually, but they need as you can see, they need these kind of dirty spaces, so that in this electric socket, I found like 1-3 spitting spiders were there. So yeah, they need these kind of spaces to stay. Spitting spider, and this you can see A male is just like after mating is sacrificing himself for the female so that she can feed on him. And as I said, yeah, typical eye arrangement. You spitting spiders are quite easily identified because you can see like these are like two hemispheres. The head is like at one hemisphere and the abdomen is like another hemisphere. So this is unique to this family. There are two genera, I believe, Dictys and Cictodes. The difference between the two is the number of claws on the is the number of claws on the leg of the spider at the tarsal claws. Difference is what differentiate two for Dictys or three for Cictodes, something like that. Other than that, there is like virtually to differentiate between them. And yeah, that's it. And this is a recluse spider. Again, six eyes, medically significant. Yeah, recluse spider is called loxoscales. The set of symptoms which show itself after the bite of this spider constitute loxoscalism. So loxoscalism has been reported from India. So yeah, again, this is synanthropic, found around human inhabitations, and its venom is medically significant. What will happen is like the place it bites. So generally, these are again docile unless and until what pushed against a corner and forced, they do not bite. They are again really docile animals. But yeah, still again, medically significant. So there are like only a handful of medically significant spiders per se. In India, it's just loxoscales and latrodectus. But in America, if you add, there is Poenuria and Australia. Like I think four or five genera are known to be medically significant. Recluse spider, this is sometimes confused with spinning spider because of the eye arrangement and all, but you can see the typical shape. The shape is quite different. It's like two hemispheres, two lados, but this is not. This is more flattish and more like a devilish thing. So yeah, do not confuse it, but stay aware of it if at all you come across one. Then you have other sac spiders. You have Horinidae, Sodaridae, Leocranidae, Clubionidae, except this one. Sodaridae is called the ant spider. So Corinidae are called ant mimic sac spiders because again they mimic ants by like constantly wiggling their abdomens and moving around, and they are arboreal, generally arboreal. How to differentiate between Zodaridae and Corinidae is of the clypeus. You can see this is significant. This area is called the clypeus, and clypeus is really significant here. But in Corinidae, it will not be so. It will just end around here. It will not be as significant as this. Like leaving the eye arrangement, yeah, that is the easiest way to say. Then Leocranidae, I would say, again, the eye arrangement is different and the jaws are quite significant in Leocranidae. Just by like, after repeatedly seeing certain species, you will know which is, how can you differentiate between. Chirachanthium is quite common. Again, what long-legged or yellow sac spiders, they are called. These are quite distinct and can easily be identified. And there is Clubionidae. Clubionidae sometimes these can be confusing, Chirachanthium and Clubionidae. But the Clubionidae thing, Clubionidae is quite marked and colorful compared to Chirachanthium, which is generally yellowish. That's one way to actually tell the difference. But there are a family and has other species which are quite distinct. A Clubionia is the one that causes confusion, but it's easy to tell actually. And yeah, thank you. And do you have any questions? Thank you for
being my one moment. There are several questions actually.
Oh my god. Okay.
So it's not thank you yet.
Okay.
Let me go one by one and see if you can manage them. I don't know if you want to take this. So by Ashwit Shetty, how to take detailed shot of web of spider during broadcast? What would the manual settings be for that?
Anna, Pawan, please answer.
This is more of a photography. We'll skip this because
I have another one. One thing I want to add. Actually, if anyone wants to get a spider ID, the thing is, don't send just the face close-ups. We cannot make out anything. We need a dorsal shot, a good dorsal shot when it is alive, not dead, and then the face shot is also required, so that we can attempt to attempt just by the face. It's not easy to ID spiders. That's it.
Dorsal and the top down, from the top.
From the top, yeah, the top, covering the head and abdomen, whole body.
So can we identify which spiders are venomous and which aren't just by their appearance, by Anjali Pujani?
As I said, you need to look after this recluse and what is that? Elytra electrodectus. Electrodectus. Actually speaking, all the spiders are venomous, except two families. One here is, as I said, Ulaboridae are when they have venom, but they are not medically significant, and most of the fangs are not sharp enough to even pierce our skin. So the venom doesn't have any effect. You just need to be aware of the lactroductus and lots of scales here. And don't mess with tarantulas. Tarantulas can give you a real pain. That's it.
Another by Anjali Pujari. Are there any remedies for interns' spider bites?
The only, I actually better consult a doctor, but some remedies actually, homemade remedies, they say works are wash it with hot water and put onion juice because it breaks down protein. I don't know how effective it is, but yeah, those are the remedies. I don't know, but better consult a doctor.
Unless you are not
under trouble unless and until you are bitten by either of the two and you are allergic to it. It will be just a plant sting for 1 or 2 days, then it will be gone. Even tarantula bites like Poicithraea, they will give a constant pain, but they will go. But Loxosceles, the recluse spider, it has significant effect, and even Lactrodectus or the brown widow spider, the venom has effect. So better be careful of these spiders, and they are docile. You do, unless and until you push them into a corner, they'll never come and bite you.
By Roma Tripathi, is there any species of spider that do not molt?
No, wants to grow. So no.
Okay. Vinay S has said first one is having pedipalps, but you told us female. How? One nimsha. Vinay, every spider has pedipalps. So
pedipalps every spider has, but it's not swollen in female, it's swollen in male.
Right.
Yeah, okay.
Which source is useful for ID in the spider?
If you want to ID spiders,
just
pardon? Yeah?
Hello, just ask Chinmay sir.
Okay, so Yenapadu question is, okay, so how do you hide Yenapadu? Stop sharing. So how, what are the sources means? There is WSC, Word Spider Catalog, in which create a free account and you can get access to all the new discoveries or all the spider, everything you get there for free, all the documents.
ओके चिन्मय हेळिदु नम टाइपिंग दैट इन द
ए फील्ड गाइड टू स्पाइडर जेनेरा ऑफ इंडिया द मोस्ट रीसेंट वन
PPT was really informative. Can you share it with us? Totally fine if you can't, just asking. Vaivani Naik. I don't know. Probably you have you.
Okay. I wanted to make one thing clear. Most of these pictures are from of my friends, and most of them are from Google, which I googled at the last minute and put it. So I just wanted to give credits to all my friends who have just like humbly donated their pics for my PPT, and even thanks to Google, and all the credit goes to them, all the picture credits. So I don't have any right over it. I've just used it for this information, and yeah, I can share the PPT. I can share it with Ishanya. I think he can create a link or something so that you can get it. Maybe.
Right. Why are female spiders bigger than male spiders? By Pratik.
Good question. Okay. Why are female spiders? Because females have a significant role to play. They want to produce children. They want to produce progeny so that the continuation have to only mate and die. So most of the and females need the bigger size enables them to store more food, and yeah, you get what I mean. I think that's the reason.
Okay. Homeschooling India and Kutila. It's by dinosaur period.
Of course, they were there before the dinosaurs. not modern spiders. As I said, the mesothelial ones, the segmented ones, they were there. The amber, the collections of the fossils from ambers date back to more than 400 billion years.
Okay. By Prathapanen, have any of spider web been used for making of bulletproof jackets?
No, they are working on it, but study of the spider, the properties of the spider web is helping scientists develop bulletproof jackets, more effective bulletproof jackets. That's what I meant.
Okay. By Shishir Kumar, is there a way to differentiate, I believe he wanted to ask, venomous and non-venomous spiders?
All spiders, except Ula Borida, all spiders are venomous. But they are not medically significant, so don't worry unless and until you want to handle them and get bitten. So chill.
By Ashwit Shetty, which spider do you want to see outside India? Which fascinates with their specific behavior? His favorite is Brazilian wandering spider.
Oh, Phoenuria! Oh my God, that's a medically significant spider. That definite death. If at all medical attention is not given to the bitten person, he will die. So good choice, bro. I just want to first finish seeing at least all the spiders of Bangalore. Then I can plan of other things. I hardly know all the spiders of Bangalore. So let's start here. Let's start from hometown, then go abroad.
Yeah. Jasmine Aretna, is there anything like old world, new world spiders? Yeah, Jasmine, this was taken up earlier in the session. So Chinmay had already answered this question.
Old world means all over Africa, Asia, and Australia, Oceania thing. But new world is Americas. So not necessarily so, because spiders are not as recent, actually. In monkeys you have old world, new world monkeys, but in spiders it's not so, because they are quite primordial and ancient. They were there since Pangaea, when they were all the continents were there as one. So no, but on the distribution you can say old world and new world, that's it. Neotropical and like that.
Prathapan, role of spider in our ecosystem. This was spoken about earlier along with slides. So yeah, a quick point, this video has been on YouTube and it will be there saved in case somebody wants to watch again from the beginning, or you missed any portion of this session. you can go back to YouTube and watch it. So Pratapan, yeah, you can probably go back to the beginning, beginning few slides and take a look at it. It was spoken about. Thanks. Thanks for the question. Anyway, so if nobody else has any questions, we are almost at the end of the session. If you have something to say, you can unmute yourselves and speak up.
Yeah, please.
Chat. Yeah.
Yeah, if you have any suggestions or like anything to improve, please let me know. And thank you all for listening patiently, really patiently. I was just nagging without any stops. So you are all really patient. I'm really happy that you attended this session. Thank you. And yeah, I want to thank Wildlife Focus, Pawan, and all for making this happen. Stay home, stay safe.
Can my camera open, Marco?
Camera open. Katlali din bhai, yeno cancel abde.
Okay. Hello. Sorry, Umar. Yeah.
I have a question. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So, some species of Menomerus and I guess Brettus in Salticidae. The female has like what the male has the swollen part at the end of the peripals, but the female also there's a lot of hair on the peripals towards the end, so the appearance looks swollen just like the male. Even though the peripalp isn't itself swollen, the hairs make it look as if it is swollen. So do you know why this happens?
No, hairs are generally present. So it like the appearance is, you can significantly clean, even in the Brettus, the significance, like the volume of the pedipalps is quite naturally seen when you see a female. Like pedipalps in general are sensitive organs. And during mating, like pedipalps come in touch and they're quite sensitive. So they are used for mating. And yeah, and also for chemical reception. So hairs are present for that same thing, but the volume of the pedipalps is quite significant in the males compared to females.
Oh, okay, thanks.
Okay. Did somebody else speak up?
Like anyone has any suggestions or anything as such, then please feel free to talk.
Yeah, feel free to comment in the chat pod as well. Quick thing, the team which was supposed to coordinate this event, Wildlife Focus Auro, they are from the Western Ghats region. So currently they have thunder showers going on. ಗುಡುಗು ಸಿಡ್ಲು ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಸೊ ನೆಟ್ವರ್ಕ್ ಇಲ್ಲ ಕರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಗಿ, ದೇ ಕುಡಂಟ್ ಮ್ಯಾನೇಜ್ ದಿಸ್ ಸೆಷನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆಸ್ಕ್ ಮೀ ಟು ಕೋಆರ್ಡಿನೇಟ್. ಸೊ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಸ್ ಟು ದೆಮ್ ಫಾರ್ ಆರ್ಗನೈಸಿಂಗ್ ಸಚ್ ಅ ಸೆಷನ್. ಅಂಡ್ ಟು ಚಿನ್ಮಯ್, ಹೂ ವಿತೌಟ್ ಹೋಲ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಎನಿ ಇನ್ಫಾರ್ಮೇಶನ್ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಪೋರ್ಡ್ ಆನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆನ್ ವಿತ್ ವಾಟ್ ಎವರ್ ಹಿ ನ್ಯೂ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಸ್ಪೈಡರ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ವಾಟ್ ಎವರ್ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಲರ್ನ್ಡ್ by his own field experience and by reading several books or papers or information on the web and by interacting with people and his observations. He shared everything without holding back. So thanks a lot to Chinmay for agreeing to conduct this session on for wildlife and in general to talk about spiders. Chinmay, dhanyavadagalu. I hope you continue doing this and may this get spread to more and more number of people.
Thank you, Pawanbhai. Thank you, everyone. Yeah. Okay.
Ishaya, enara idya? Heladu?
Hello.
Ha, kelis.
Heli, bro.
Kelta idya.
Ha.
Ha, yeah. And then one more question I have asked. Could you please conduct webinar on spiders in each land?
What?
One by one. Oh, okay. Please conduct webinars on species level identification of spiders in each family/group one by one in future. Is it possible?
Oh my god, no, no way, chance illa. No, no. I am like, I'm an enthusiast, I'm not, and for that what is needed is I need to take specimens of all the species, dissect them and show you under a microscope. Illa illa illa, nani gottilla bhai, namage yenu gottilla, I don't know. I just show photos and yeah, I can like that's what I do on Insta. I just give visual cues on potential species, yeah, and now no plans as of now to cut them open now, so yeah. No, for us, no, no.
Okay, that's it, I guess. It's been a good 2.5 hours. Thank you, everybody, for being such patient listeners. Sumne kutkondu kelisikondiddakke dhanyavaadagalu. Thanks for asking questions and everything. Yeah, if you have any questions or follow-up, ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ಈಶಾನ್ಯ ಅಥವಾ ವೈಲ್ಡ್ ಲೈಫ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಫೋಕಸ್ ಟೀಮ್ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಕಾಂಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಿ.
ವಾಟ್ಸ್ಆಪ್ ಗ್ರೂಪ್ ಇದೆ, ಅಲ್ಲೂ ಕೇಳ್ಬಹುದು.
ಹಾ, ವಾಟ್ಸ್ಆಪ್ ಗ್ರೂಪ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ.
ಇಲ್ಲ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ನನಗೆ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಾ